afternoon to everybody who's taking time out to join us. Thank you very much. This is our series of webinars on talking to industry experts to get their views on markets, trends, etc. Scriptbox, as you know, is basically geared towards education, learning, about information, as much as it's about well-selected investments and curated investments. So without taking too much of your time, I'd like you to introduce Kalpen Parekh, one of the absolute stalwarts of the industry. Start right from his MBA days immediately, and probably he would have been investing even while doing his MBA. He's been in the industry for over 22 years, knows it very, very well, and is currently president at one of the more renowned asset management companies, DSP. We thought we'd do something slightly different today in the webinar. We've had a few series where we've talked about that this too shall pass, and it's good to remain invested. So while we completely believe that, and we still advise and suggest that we continue, I thought I'll ask Kalpen to tell us about how does he actually manage money? So what is the process they follow? So sort of help us understand their world a little bit better, because after all, what they do impacts our lives materially. So it'll be a slightly different webinar. We'll try to understand from Kalpen. I'll hand over to him. There is a bunch of questions I can ask, but I'd rather that he just talks about how do mutual funds actually work. And as we go along, I'll ask more questions. And then obviously towards the end, you can add your questions in the chat window, and we'll try our best to answer as many as possible. We should be about 40 minutes. And yeah, if you need to extend a little bit, we will. So without much more, I'll hand over to Kalpen.
Atul, thank you. And the team at Scriptbox, thank you for inviting me and DSP for this session. Though I think you have left the difficult questions for me, you should have called me for the easier ones, because it's easy to, you know, give nice statements and hope that we continue to stay invested and achieve our compounding. Having said that, it's very heartening to know that people like you are going one step further to understand how is money managed. You know, there is one school of thought which says that you guys have been around for 25 years. This is my check, or this is my transaction. Take it and manage it. I don't need to know what do you need or what do you do about it. And this is a more interesting, intense conversation about the nuts and bolts of how money is managed. So to start with, what I want to highlight is, you know, DSP has been around for 25 years, starting from 96. And why am I saying, you know, this background is because in these 25 years, we have seen everything that can go right and everything that can go wrong. So we've seen, you know, phases like the 2000 melt up when the tech bubble happened. And then for 4 years, nothing happened in the economy after the bust in the tech space. Technology funds fell by 85% in their NAVs. Then we have seen the 2003 to 2007 run. Now, that was the defining moment for a lot of us who were early in our career, because we thought that is true investing, where markets went up by 7 times in a period of 4 years. I'm repeating it again. 7 times means 700% in a period of 4 years. And we thought those type of returns are our birthright, because you know, when you are in the thick of the moment, you presume that is the new normal, or that is actually the normal. And then one fine day, January 2008, is when the global financial crisis came through, and you know, almost 60% drop in prices. So when prices drop by 60% on a base of 7 times growth, it takes you back almost 8 to 10 years in your portfolio value. And that was a big learning, that, you know, never take the current trend for granted. The only truth in investing, and the only truth, whatever all of us may say, is defined in only two words, which is markets fluctuate. Nothing is permanent. The only thing that is permanent is fluctuations. Of course, the reality is that over a long period of time, the trend is upwards, but intermittently it will fluctuate. The second truth, and you know, after hearing the second truth, you might say, I don't want to continue with the webinar. The second truth is most of us cannot tell you what will happen in the next 1, 2, or 3 years. So you know, keeping these two things in mind, what I want to tell you is that at DSP, the way we manage money is we realize that one, there is fluctuation. Two, there is randomness. And three, short term cannot be forecasted or predicted. So then how do we do justice to the hard-earned money that all of you give us? And that's where comes the role of investing rules and frameworks that we put at play when we manage your money every day at DSP. Let me also tell you, and something which will probably give you a lot of confidence, is at DSP, our starting rule is every rupee of every employee in DSP is invested in the funds of DSP. So that is the reason I'm highlighting this is not out of choice. This is out of mandate. This is out of rule. And the reason to do this Atul, just clarify if I'm audible, because someone messaged that he's not able to hear. I'm audible to most people.
Yes. Okay.
So the reason why we institutionalize this rule, we call this skin in the game. A lot of institutions around the world, some in India, demonstrate this. This is to highlight that our money is standing with your money, and our money is at the same risk as your money is. This is to give confidence to all of you that we understand ups and downs, but we also will give our best to make the most out of our investing. Now, having said that, we come to the third principle, that when we build portfolios, of course, mutual funds have multiple asset classes. Mutual funds are not only about equities. You have equities, you have fixed income, you have global equities, you have gold, you have multiple styles of products that are available. But our defining approach is there are certain rules that we have created, and a lot of these rules are available on our website. We are happy to share it with you, Atul, for you to subsequently share it with the entire team. These are like 10, 12 page detailed documents. What we call as our investment philosophy document, which actually clarifies what is the way of life, or the formula, or the method for every scheme in which money is given to us. Now at DSP, we broadly have four styles in equity. One style is a focus on a very high quality, high ROE, high ROC companies which are growing at 2 to 3 times of the rest of the economy. So our primary drivers of investing are looking for companies that are good, looking for companies that are available at good prices, and then staying invested for long periods of time. So these three lines truly define how we manage money. Now, this is a lot of English, but we actually have data points to define what constitutes good companies, what constitutes good prices, and then what are the time horizons for which we stay invested. Now, good companies for us, and then before I come to that, method of selection, we put a lot of emphasis on elimination of companies. So, we all know that there are some 5,000 listed stocks in India. The benchmarks on which we are measured are largely the BSE 500 or the Nifty 500. So the top 500 companies by market cap. Most of our portfolios do not own all 500. They largely will own between 30 stocks to 60 stocks. So there's a lot of elimination first. So our starting premise is, what will we not buy? Where will we not invest? Because end of the day, it is your and my hard-earned money. We have rules at what type of companies would we like, what type of management we like. So we look for a long-term track record of these companies, these managements, what they talk in their annual reports and what they actually do. I was just sitting with my investment team day before yesterday. Every Wednesday, we have a no-noise day. It's a day of reflection where the entire 20-member investment team shuts itself off from the outside world and just does reflection. Okay, these are the companies. What are the trends? How is the economy behaving? And we choose each company. Now we look at 10 years of annual report. So we say that, okay, what was the management commentary every year? And in the next year, is the management actually maintaining the same commentary or changing its strategy? So let's say some company says that, next year we are going to do so much of CapEx in this line of business. But in the next year, if the narrative is something else, we know that this is only lip service. And there is lack of continuity of strategy. And that means that, probably it's not the management of our choice. And hence, I may not want to invest. So there's a lot of analysis done on, the balance sheet, the words of the management and the actions of the management. And then, of course, data. We avoid companies where there are a lot of red flags. We avoid companies where there's a lot of, leverage. So, for example, if companies have 1 rupee of equity and 5 rupees or 3 rupees or 4 rupees of debt, then it's not easy, because all the profit they generate will go back in paying back that debt, except in financials where the rules are different. So for every sector, we have rules defined, and then, elimination first, and then we select companies. Primarily, there are two pillars. One is, companies which have high ROEs. So in India, if you do nothing, India is a country with high interest rates. Forget the recent trend where interest rates have come down, but at large in India, interest rates have been around 8%. So if you and I do nothing, we can earn 8% in Government of India bonds, RBI bonds, fixed deposits and all of that. So we look for companies which can, compound their capital at roughly two times of the prevailing interest rate. So if interest rates are at 8, at least 15% is a good threshold. So all businesses which can earn 15% on the equity, and not just that, they can keep reinvesting that profits back again at that run rate. So if you look at all our portfolios, the weighted average return on equity of the portfolio will be anywhere between 17 to 20% on an ROE basis. And the second filter that we look for is now we have established these are great companies. So these 50 companies are companies we love. We would love to put our money in. But at what price are they available? So valuation becomes a second parameter. That are these companies available at 15 PE multiple, 20 PE multiple, 30, 50. Some of them are available at 100 also. So these are the two parameters that we look for, and then we build the portfolio. We look for liquidity. We look for, you know, how much should be the weight out of 100 rupees, which company should get 5 rupees, which should get 1 rupee. Lot depends on the size of their balance sheet, the strength of the balance sheet. So these are, you know, a lot of nuances. It could take me 2-3 hours to take you through that. But I would urge you to, you know, connect with Stripbox and look for our investment philosophy documents, which will give you a very detailed deep dive on how we do what we do.
Kalpen, that was really, really valuable. I mean, and the commitment that your employees make, that they put their money where their mouth is just phenomenal. I mean, we follow a very similar philosophy at Scriptbox, that employees should be invested through our platform. And yeah, we can't mandate 100%, but to the extent possible, we do encourage people to use our own product as much as possible. So two questions from leading on, and thank you for being so transparent about the process. And I hope it assures our investors that there's a lot of research, a lot of diligence, a lot of time which goes into selecting the right securities or the right stocks to go into a portfolio. And we'll stick with the equity discussion. We'll come back to debt in a subsequent manner. So two questions from that. Given that none of us have seen the COVID coming before or the pandemic impact, how would you go about factoring that into your existing investment philosophy and looking forward?
So to be very honest, if we were to actually analyze the COVID impact and put it in our philosophy, it would make us very defensive, whereas the markets are completely running in a very different tangent. So that would also make us run slower than the market right now. To be honest, most of us, have gone wrong in not predicting COVID. So it's very ironical that we are also asked what will happen post-COVID. So if we could not analyze BC, which is before COVID, why do you have confidence that we'll analyze post-COVID also? So we think that, you know, some of these events are unpredictable. You can't really model for that. But, you know, we go back to core principles that what are we here for? We are here to look for businesses which will survive at least the next few decades or at least the next 10 years. You know, no one knows the future beyond 10 years. Let me not get there. But what type of companies will remain, you know, core and integral to markets at large, to consumers at large? And the consumers could be Indian consumers. It could be global consumers. So we look for such companies which have good products, which have survival inherent in their balance sheet. When we say strong balance sheets, the true beauty of strong balance sheets gets tested in times like this. When, you know, what? Just imagine what are the times that we're talking of. We're talking of times where, let's say, if a company has debt on its books, it has employees, it has cost structures, but it cannot sell the product. For the last 4 months, if it has not been able to sell products and not get any revenue, but the cost meter is ticking, how does it survive? So we look for companies which are survivors, which can actually flourish in times like this. So to give you an example, while, you know, some of these companies have seen 30, 35, 40% fall in price, and again, they've bounced back also. You look at banks. Some of the largest banks that we have in our portfolio are HDFC Bank and ICICI Bank, for example. You know that these banks will survive even post-COVID, because people will need capital, people will need loans, people will need banking products for their long-term needs. And the biggest profit pool in India comes from banking. So we use this connection to, you know, add our exposure to some of the banks which could be winners at the cost of some other banks in the system. So some of the tier two banks actually, which had good growth potential 3 months back, may actually struggle in the next round, because post-COVID, most of the deposits are going only to the top two banks, only to SBI and HDFC and ICICI. But the smaller banks, which were very promising 3 months back, may struggle now. So we use this phase to say that, okay, let me reduce my weights in the smaller bank and move back to the larger bank. As an example, in NBFCs, where again a large amount of noise and fear is there that, okay, you know, if the money that has been lent out to borrowers, if the borrowers exercise moratorium, and if they stop giving back their borrowed money back to these NBFCs, NBFCs will struggle. So, you know, there was a time India had some 1,000+ NBFCs 20 years back. Today, the top five NBFCs capture 70-80% of the profitability. So we say that, okay, we don't even want five. Which are the top two? Which are the you know, successful guys who have a business model to succeed? So we put money there. Telecom, for example, you know, around a year back, we started increasing exposure to telecom, not a year back, but maybe 9 months back, when we realized that it's becoming only a 2 or 3 player market. 10 years back, when some of these telecom stocks were at their all-time high, there were 12 telecom players. Today, there are only 2 or 3. So what? How does our team think that while there is consolidation, it means there's a lot of bloodbath in the industry, but the survivors will now, you know, succeed in the next 10 years. What do we not like about telecom? We don't like the fact that it's very capital intensive. It needs huge amount of capital, equity and debt. So fundamentally, we don't like companies which need capital, because if you want high return on capital, you need businesses which have low capital and high growth prospects. So telecom does not tick mark that. Banks don't tick mark that, but they still are a part of our portfolio at a point in time. IT companies don't need capital. Pharma companies don't need so much of capital. Consumer companies don't need capital. So we have the winners or the leaders in each of these. We'll have Asian Paints. So in today's environment, such companies will be winners. A Colgate will be a winner. A Hindustan Lever will be a winner, because, you know, the intake of these type of day-to-day products has actually gone up. So we look for these type of businesses. And then, of course, we apply the price dimension, that are they rightly priced? There's no point in buying a great company at some crazy price. To give an example, Infosys, great company, part of our portfolio, in the year 2000 was priced at 100 times price to earning multiple. Since then till today, it would have grown its profits at around 20% CAGR. But the stock price for the next 10 years made no returns, because it was already overpriced. So coming back, we look for companies which can protect their return ratios, which can protect their profitability, which can keep growing their revenues, do not have too much of debt, can take care of expenses, assuming if the lockdowns were to continue for the next 6 months or 1 year also. So survivors, winners, companies which have successful products, which are important in the lives of you know, the customer market. And then the last condition we look at is, what price are we paying? Unfortunately, the price that we are paying today for most of these good companies is much higher than what we would love it to be. So in our simple terms, we say that valuations are expensive. We wish they were cheaper. They are not reflecting the crisis that is playing out in the markets right now. But so be it. That's how the markets behave.
Thank you, Kalpin. That was very, very, I mean, valuable. And I trust the listeners are more knowledgeable than before they began. I mean, at Scriptbox, we follow a very similar philosophy. We believe in longevity. One criteria for us is look for people who have a track record, who've been around. Though past performance is no indicator of future, but it does tell you about philosophy. It tells you about how people select the stocks underlying, and it just plays out over time. And hopefully we can continue to deliver to our customers the way you do. So love the fact that there is so much diligence, there is ongoing monitoring. The related question would be, so how often does a fund manager actually what's the average churn of a portfolio typically? Is it something you guys are stable with, or are you looking to do something all the time?
Sure.
And a related question, which I think will be important, is that there is a tendency of a lot of investors, especially mutual fund investors, to time the market. Sensex is low, please come in now, this is a great time. We have a product called Systematic Transfer Plan, and some of the guys will say, no, make it daily, make it weekly. And we say, it doesn't matter, because after all, the fund manager can sit on cash for as long as he wants. So this philosophy that the fund manager is not forced to do something every day, and that combined with how often do you actually act, would help our investors decide not to get panicky if the market's good. The Sensex is not really a true indicator of a fund manager's performance every day. So is that true? Yeah. And elaborate on that.
When it comes to, you know, portfolio activity, there are two schools of thought. One school of thought, which is a very traditional old school of thought that people like Warren Buffett have, spoken about, is that if you like a good company, then treat it as a marriage, become an owner of that company by buying those stocks and stay with them till the time the companies remain good company. So you know, it's like I tell my wife, if I'm a good husband, stay with me for life. Don't need to really rotate. So that's one school of life. Having said that, the other school of thought in investing is that, you know, you have the beautiful luxury as a fund manager to keep allocating capital between the best promoters at every point in time. So in one cycle, the best promoters could be in the pharma space or the consumer space. 2 years later, because markets, you know, prices run up a lot or somewhere else prices come down, you have the luxury to take money out from what is more expensive, time it and take the money and give to what is cheaper. So for example, you know, imagine the grueling hard work that Mr. Aditya Puri has to do to build the bank. And even if the trends are negative or difficult, he has no choice. They can't, you know, stop the bank and say, okay, now let's go to some other business. But you and I have that luxury to say that, okay, while they fix the issues in banking and, you know, come out stronger, if let's say COVID is going to affect banking a lot more, let me, you know, take some money out from HDFC Bank and give it to HDFC Limited or give it to an Infosys or a new trend which is playing out. So there are two schools of thought and both have merit in them. As long as you have a technique to manage it. Like in a cricket team, you have a Rahul Dravid who will defend very well. He's the wall. He believes in not losing his wickets. And you have, let's say, a Virat Kohli who will say that, you know, I will have different styles of shots in my armory. And depending on what the ball is, I'll play. So at DSP, we are blessed to have, you know, both these styles and we respect both of them. We don't take a binary view that this is right or that is right. Sometimes, you know, that becomes very theoretical. So there is a buy and hold approach and there is a very active approach. So for example, if you look at portfolios that Atul manages or Vineet Samre manages, our head of equity, his portfolio turnover is around 25%. So which means he buys companies for roughly and holds them for 4 to 5 years. So there are some companies in his portfolio which have been there for 8-10 years. And then there are some companies where he realizes, okay, I bought with a certain hypothesis, I made some mistake, let me get out within a year. So that's a more long-term approach. Then we have, for example, Rohit Singhania. Rohit manages our opportunities fund and the tax fund. So Rohit has a very flexible mindset. He says that I'm here to make money from the movement in stock prices. So if I believe that this stock has run up a lot, great business, but if it has run up a lot, I will not hesitate to take some profits out and give it to another company which has not run up too much. So for example, there were times when, you know, when everyone was buying Maruti and Maruti stock price was running up a lot, he said, I'm happy to, you know, book some profits in Maruti and move to Mahindra and Mahindra, which is it's again a good company, but cheaper, relatively much cheaper because it's more catering to the rural markets and stuff like that. Or when in the last 1 year, when all, you know, high quality NBFCs were running up. So he did not have Bajaj Finance in the portfolio, but he had more of Axis Bank and ICICI Bank. And in this phase, when Bajaj Finance came down, he added more to, so that's an opportunistic style, and which is why the name is called Equity Opportunities Fund. So his portfolio has a turnover of roughly around 70% or 75%, which means 1.5 or 2 years is when he times the market, or rather he doesn't time the market, he times the sectors and the companies. So to you as investors, to the second question, once you have decided which style you want to, you know, choose, depending on track record, our track record and our performance, let the fund manager do that work for you. Because if to make the same dish, if there are 5 cooks who try to apply their techniques, the dish that you will make will lose its nutrition as well as taste. You decide who is in control. So if you want to be in control, then actually go and buy passive funds and go and buy sector funds where you can decide today I want healthcare. After 6 months, I want to move to technology. Then I want to move to banking. Then I want to move to global stocks. Then you become the driver. But ensure that you are a good driver. Ensure that you actually understand investing. Investing is not as easy as we all believe. Everyone in India thinks he can be a cricketer and he can be selected in a cricket team in the last 11. But obviously only 11 can come. So keep that in mind. The second question that you asked, Atul, which is systematic transfer plans, daily, weekly, and all of that. So let me admit that I used to do daily systematic transfer plans 10 years back. My chartered accountant once called up and said that I don't want to do work for you. Because you in the last 3 years have done some 600 transfers. Every year there are 200 working days. So when you transfer from debt to equity every day through daily STP, you have 200 transfers. And I had done it for 3 years. So he said you have 600 transfers. And whenever you sell the fund, because you know I was a short-term, very bad investor 15 years back. Every time you sell, for every transaction, there are 600 purchase prices. And after doing all of that, have you seen what's your return? Your return is less than a fixed deposit. So while you're doing all this activity illusion, and of course, you know, we've all made these mistakes and learned from these mistakes. So one thing is very clear. In fact, you could have a calculator to show that quarterly STPs or monthly STPs give the same return or sometimes better return than daily STPs. That is the best way to, you know, train our mind and believe. So ideally, systematic transfer plans have to be transferred over a cycle. Why are we doing transfers? We are doing transfers because we say that we don't want to buy everything right now, because perhaps the markets are, euphoric or more expensive. I want to wait them to get cheap. They don't get cheap in days or weeks. They take a full cycle of 2-3 years to get cheap. So then do it over a full cycle. I do a systematic transfer plan in two funds of DSP. One is the DSP small cap fund and one is the DSP US fund. I believe that the small cap fund is cheaper today because, you know, it's sitting on a 5-year low right now from a NAV point of view, whereas the US fund is expensive. So the small cap fund, I would want to invest faster because it's cheap, whereas the US fund is more expensive. So I'll do it over a longer period of time. So those are some rules or techniques that you should, you know, with your advisor, talk, define, and whatever you do, let there be logic behind it. Don't do it because someone else is doing it. Don't do it because you read some headline that now STPs make sense. You know, today the most common headlines are gold makes sense and international funds make sense. Now, everyone is asking that should we invest in international funds? Of course you should, but not because, you know, everyone is talking about it. There has to be reason for what you do. So the only message I want to give you is, first, be sure that, you know, you understand the techniques of investing and where you are investing. Then take charge. And two, let there be a logical reason of why you're doing what you're doing. There should be evidence that this style can make money for you. So I call it evidence-based investing. Whatever you do, I have, and I'm sharing some of my mistakes with you because I think the best teacher is your own mistakes, provided you have an open mind and humility to look at them. So I did an exercise, like I said, between 2004 to 2008, when markets were running up one way. And because they were going up so fast, the churn ratio in my own investments was very high. And then I realized that my actual return is much lower than just, you know, buying a Nifty and letting it be Nifty. So extra transaction does not mean extra return. They say that, you know, activity is like a soap. When it crosses many hands, it will become thin without giving you the effect of, you know, using the soap. So the more hands it crosses, so churn fundamentally in our portfolio should be reasonable, not very high. So even in our funds, we have a condition. We tell our fund managers, you cannot buy a stock and sell a stock without a logical reason. So like I said, we have a 12-page investment principle document. If the fund manager is buying a stock, the document should be able to justify. If he's selling the stock, the document should be able to justify. If not, don't unnecessarily churn and pay brokerage. So timing is not easy. And personally, my view is you should time the market, no doubt. But only once in few years when there are some big turning points, when you are at a huge bubble. So when markets go to 30, 35 times price to earning multiple, which is a very rare, peak, that's the time you think of rebalancing a little bit through your asset allocation. Or when markets go into a very, very, you know, other extreme of bear market of 11, 12, 13 P multiple, when there is extreme pessimism, because that's the time to increase exposure. In the middle, do nothing, just keep driving. It is like a flight where you have to take some action when the flight takes off. So you have to put your seatbelt, you know, you have to ensure everything is fine. You have to take some action then and when the flight is about to land. In between, so if you are in a 15-hour flight, for the first 5 minutes and last 5 minutes, you do some action. In the balance 14 hours and 50 minutes, focus on the movie, focus on the food, take some rest, do some meditation. So in the journey, stay balanced. At extremes, with your advisor, take decisions.
Thank you so much, Kalpen. That's really useful and insightful. Without trying to promote Scriptbox, very similar philosophy. So we used to call it, fill it, shut it, forget it. Trust the experts. This is what we do for a living, right? It's our interest to make you successful. So your advisor, in this case, or your money manager, wants you to succeed. Remember, it is our job to make you succeed. We might not always succeed, but that's the intent is to make your money grow. And that's why the money managers exist. Trust the professionals because that's what they do for a living. Sorry, Kalpen, you were saying something.
So just in extension, since you spoke about time horizon, what I spoke was literature, English. Let me also bring some maths in this because ultimately investing is a blend of art and science. Why do we keep saying invest for the long term? It's not just for sake of being cliched that we say invest for the long term. Put it in the formula of compounding. When you look at the formula of compounding, what does it say? Amount is equal to principal 1 plus R by 100 raised to the power of T, right? So when P and R are, you know, below, and R has the plus sign before it. So the return part has plus sign. P, which is the principal, which is the money that you can save, has a multiplication sign. And T, which is the third variable, has an exponential sign. So between the three variables, R, P and T, repeated, R, P and T, which variable is maths giving importance to? Maths is giving a plus sign to returns. Maths is giving a P, you know, a higher weightage to principal, which is the amount you save every month. And maths is giving the highest weightage to time by giving it exponentiality. So in the journey of compounding wealth, the order of importance should be how long will you invest for, how much money will you save, and what return will you make. In the real world, the order of importance is to how much return will I make. Now, honestly, you know, while all of us intend to generate reasonably good returns versus other alternatives like bonds or fixed income, but there are times when, you know, market cycles don't give you the best return. So returns are never predictable. I can never tell you that you'll make 20% return. It's easy for me to say you'll make 15%, 12%, but you're not going to come back and catch me 10 years later. The variable to keep in mind is always how long, because the longer your investment is, the higher your compounding is. Our most successful investor in DSP, let me tell you, our oldest fund is 23 years old now. Its CAGR return is around 19% CAGR over 23 years. And you'll be shocked to know that we have only 23 investors out of our 23 lakh investors who have lived through this journey and made 19% CAGR over such a long period of time. So real compounding happens through our own behavior. It's not about what will markets do, what will fund manager do, what will Prime Minister Modi do, what will Trump do or RBI do. It is how long can we invest. And now, giving you an example, if you were to earn 20% return for 3 years versus 12% return for 10 years, the absolute amount that you'll make will be higher at 12% return over 10 years than 20 over 3 years. So the time variable, if you have to take just one message back from today's session, keep time on your side. The longer you invest for, and what has the richest investor on earth said? Warren Buffett, who is now 89 years. He started investing at the age of 11. That means 78 years of compounding. Imagine 78 years. The average holding period of an Indian investor is 2 years. Those are what compounding will we make? Now, what does he say? See the greed in him. How, you know, uske jaisa bada banya I have not seen. He says, I started investing at the age of 11 and I repent that I started 11 years late. Because he says, I want to ensure that every moment of my life, my money should compound. Now, when you, that is the type of mindset with which if we, you know, bring discipline to our money, magic can happen.
Thank you very much, Aminia. So we can't emphasize that more than anything else. That remain invested. Try to, there is no good time. Every day is a good time to invest. If you can afford it, keep putting more principal into the business. The other piece you spoke about, those who survive will thrive, right? And this philosophy applies across the companies you buy, the funds you invest in, your own philosophy. So if you remain invested and survive, you will thrive. So that's the high level message. I'll throw the floor open to a few more questions. So sure. One is about should we do it ourselves? I mean, we know what the top five stocks to buy are. But I think there is more than a list investing. Absolutely, if you feel confident, if you have the principles and the discipline of research, and you have the resources available and the time available to do this on a daily basis, you have the Wednesday available to do reflection, absolutely do that. Otherwise, just trust the experts. When you have an eye problem, you go to a doctor. You don't try to do it yourself. Similarly, money is a very serious topic. And our advice is to trust the advisors and trust the fund managers. But I'll let Kalpen give me his views on that.
So, you know, trust me, I feel I have more resources available to me if I want to make my investment decisions on my own. In fact, why did we institutionalize this rule in DSP that we cannot even buy stocks? So it's not just about investing in DSP mutual funds, but as a rule, we say that our best research and our best ideas will come together in our portfolios. Why do we separately need to then buy and sell stock and, you know, spend our time and attention on doing that? We rather build the business and we make the business much bigger. But coming, let's say, from a consumer point of view, like Atul mentioned, only if you think you have done all the homework and, you know, you have that technique, that formula of what good investing styles are or good principles are. And if you are confident and comfortable with that, by all means, you should go ahead and do it. But data says, so let's say there are 2 crore broking accounts in the country, stock broking accounts. And data says that if you look at the average returns of all the transactions which have happened in these broking accounts over the last, 10, 20 years, the average return may be less than simple Nifty, which means most investors buy and sell either at the wrong time or invest in the wrong stocks. So please invest yourself. I'm not discouraging you. It's always good if you have more and more scientific, well-behaved investors in our marketplace. If you can do it on your own, do it. Ben Graham has a very beautiful statement in his book called The Intelligent Investor. He said that if you put your hard-earned money into the markets with all the efforts and learning and discipline and reading, you should be reading balance sheets, annual reports, listening to management commentaries and all of that, then you are an investor. But if you still invest without doing all of it, then you are a speculator. And it's okay to be both. But look for data again, that being an investor makes more money for you, being a speculator makes more money for you, number one. Number two, today, the best of investment management is available to all of you at such a nominal cost of, 1.5-2%. End of the day, you are, and secondly, in a more tax efficient way. So the mutual fund vehicle is such a beautiful vehicle, at reasonably low cost, at very high degree of tax efficiency, daily liquidity, superior transparency, and solid governance. We are blessed to have a regulator like SEBI. A lot of regulators outside come back and take, some templates from SEBI, that the way you've governed the mutual fund industry in terms of, transparency, disclosures and all of that. So you're getting a great product. I'm not, wearing my mutual fund hat and saying this to you, but I'm saying this to you what I personally do. Every rupee of mine since 2008 has only been in a mutual fund. My DMAT account was inactive till 3 years back. I had to activate it because there were some stocks which I wanted to sell. And I just have some 7 or 8 stocks left now. Now, I'm not saying that buying stocks directly is not a source of being a good investor. Do it only if you can study well and then apply it and be disciplined to, understand. Because, another data says that almost 90% of stocks don't make money. Only 10% stocks in the market make money. So you need to have that rule book to reach out to that 10%. How do you know which 10%? That's where, again, the role of experts come in. And ours is a very competitive industry where, there are 40 mutual funds, there are 200 portfolio management services and boutiques which are there. So we cannot take our job for granted. And lastly, if our portfolios don't do well, you will have a choice to, go to Scriptbox and move to some 4 other funds. Scriptbox will throw us out of the recommendation. But our own money, which is in our funds, cannot go elsewhere because we have to live with that. So I think there is reasonable discipline to ensure that, we give good results to our investors. And not just at DSE, but at large in the industry.
Thanks very much. I really appreciate Kalpen. We are nearly out of time. There are a couple of questions on how long is long term. Long term is forever. Long term is forever. It's for you to leave a legacy, for you to live your life. If you don't need the money, there is let it compound. There is no... it depends on your asset allocation models. Talk to your advisor. Money you need in 6 years, money you need in 10 years for your children's education, money you need for your retirement, money you need to live your retirement. People are going to live for 40 years in their retirement. So long term is forever. You just need to be patient and trust the process. And there's another question on ETFs and index funds. It's your choice. It's again, talk to your advisor, talk to your wealth manager as to what do you believe is the right blend of all of this in your particular portfolio, depending on your goals and your needs. So again, Kalpen, thank you very much for all your inputs. To the people who we've not been able to answer the questions specifically in the webinar itself, be rest assured, we've taken your name down. We have your access to your email. We will respond to you individually. It's in our interest to answer every question. The specific questions on tax saving fund in DSP, I'll let Kalpen answer that. There's one more question about which we do at Scriptbox. We do, like Kalpen said, we review the portfolio every year to make sure that the fund manager's promise continues. And like they review stock, we review the fund manager performance. and the underlying funds. And if we believe that we're not trying to exit the other or the older fund, but if we believe fresh money can go into a new fund, we do recommend that. And that's part of just good investing practice, that you just continue to monitor what you have. So fill it or shut it and forget it is for the category, not a particular investment. So you need to actively monitor your portfolio, and that's what your wealth manager does for you. But yeah, there's a quick tactical question on the tax saving fund from DSP.
Our fund is called DSP Tax Saver Fund. So that's the fund that gives you the tax advantage, and it's a fund with a reasonably long track record. It's one of our very precious funds because that fund gives us the maximum number of investors. And most of the investors in that fund are, people like you and me who are salaried employees. So we recognize that this is their hard-earned money. So it's a fund we really like a lot. And we invest a lot of our time and effort in nurturing that product and growing that product. It's called DSP Tax Saver Fund.
Thank you very much, Kalpen. I think we are completely out of time and we want to respect that. Thank you to the entire audience for being part of the session. I hope it was of value to us. Kalpen, once again, best of luck to you and the team. And to all of us, stay invested, stay safe. Have a lovely weekend, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Arthur. See you.